Millions of people get bladder infections from time to time, but there are some people who develop the symptoms of bladder infections who don't respond to the treatments. Now, many of those people have a disease that is called interstitial, and I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, cystitis. It mostly affects women. It is very tough to diagnose, and often it's very difficult to live with, as we're going to hear. Dr. Vicki Ratner is a physician at Montefiore Medical Center here in New York City. She has this disease and has formed an association to help others who have the disease. Dr. Philip Hanno is an assistant professor of urology at the University of Pennsylvania. He's doing research on this disease. Good morning, Dr. Ratner. Nice to have you with us. Good morning, Dr. Hanno. First of all, what is it? Did I pronounce it properly?
Yeah, interstitial cystitis.
All right, what is it?
And it is an inflammation of the bladder, and it's actually an inflammation of the lining of the bladder and the bladder muscle. Usually in basic cystitis, which women get, that's caused by bacteria, and it's fairly easy to treat. But nobody knows the cause of this inflammation, and it's a whole different ballgame.
And what are the symptoms?
The symptoms are urgency and frequency. Some of these patients will get up 10 times a night to void during the day. They may void every 30 or 45 minutes. They always know where the nearest bathroom is. In early stages, the bladder capacity is normal, and the normal bladder holds about 400 cc's, which is about the same as a can of soda. But in the late stages, the bladder capacity can shrink to 2 or 3 ounces. And that becomes
pain?
Untreatable. It's pain when the bladder fills, relieved by voiding, is the hallmark of interstitial cystitis. And many of these patients can point to the exact area where they have the pain, very severe at times.
Any treatment?
There are different treatments. There are medications that can be given by mouth, anti-inflammatory drugs. There are medications that are put directly into the bladder, and this is often very helpful. One of them is DMSO, which there's been a lot of talk about.
But no cure?
There is no cure. Right now, we're pretty much treating symptoms rather than curing the disease because we don't know what causes the disease.
All right, Dr. Ratner, how serious is your disease?
I unfortunately have a very severe case. It's extremely painful all the time. It's kind of like having a raging toothache or a raging earache all the time, except that there's no cure yet. It's important to say that everybody has a different constellation of symptoms. Some women have a milder case and other women have a more severe case.
How do you function in your work?
Well, it's very difficult. It's very stressful on top of an already stressful situation. I'm doing a surgical internship at Montefiore.
Oh, a surgical intern while you're dealing with it?
Yes.
So how could, well, that's a whole other story about leaving OR, operating room, that kind of thing. How many doctors did you go to before you were diagnosed correctly?
I saw a total of 14 doctors, 10 of whom were urologists. I was a third-year medical student at the time, and I came down with terrible symptoms. And I went to the doctor, and they said, well, we don't see anything wrong. You don't have a urine infection. And it was devastating because I had nowhere to turn to for help. So what I did was I went from doctor to doctor in search of an answer to the problem because it was that severe. I really had no other choice. And eventually what I did was I went to the medical library myself, and I researched out everything myself. And I came across several articles that sounded just like what I had, and they described a special test that you needed to have in order to diagnose this. And I brought it back to one of my earlier, the doctors I had seen initially, and I really had to beg for the test. And finally it was done, and that confirmed the diagnosis. But that was a year later, after I had lived with this for a year.
How do you, just briefly, doctor, how do you account for the fact that so many doctors, specialists in the area, couldn't diagnose?
Yeah, there's a wastebasket diagnosis in urology called urethral syndrome. Half of women who have symptoms of a urinary tract infection never grow any bacteria in the urine. And it can be very difficult to pick out this particular entity among that large population. In addition, the initial descriptions of interstitial cystitis described an ulcer in the bladder, and in reality there is generally no specific ulcer that you see, so a lot of urologists who look for an ulcer won't find one and they won't make the diagnosis.
Doctor, you formed the Interstitial Cystitis Association,
yes,
right? To make people aware of what's
yes.
going on?
We act as a network of support for patients who have the disease, as well as a resource center for physicians, because we get a lot of letters from physicians. And new research is starting with Dr. Hanno at University of Pennsylvania, as well as my own medical center with the Department of Urology and several other medical centers.
Well, we hope this has helped by talking about it here this morning on the program. Thank you, doctors, very much. And as we said, this disease has been discussed infrequently, at best on national television and radio. If you want, if you think you might have the disease, or someone in your family, or if you're in the medical profession, want more information, write to Interstitial Cystitis Association, P.O. Box 4178, Great Neck, New York, 11027. Interstitial Cystitis Association, P.O. Box 4178, Great Neck, New York, 11027. And again, doctors, thanks very much. And we'll be back after this. It's 8:15.
It is now 18 minutes after 8. About 500,000 people in our country, mostly women, suffer from a bladder disease that till recently was rarely talked about. It's called interstitial cystitis. It's very difficult to diagnose. It can be difficult to live with. It is chronic. Well, yesterday, the first international medical conference on it was held. Dr. Philip Hanno is an associate professor of urology at the University of Pennsylvania, and Dr. Vicki Ratner is a medical resident in New York who has the disease. She founded the Interstitial Cystitis Association, which helps others with the disease, and both were at yesterday's conference, and it's nice to have you both with us.
Thank you.
Dr. Hanno, first of all, why don't you explain to us what this disease is?
Interstitial cystitis is a disease that mimics urinary tract infection. The patients have urgency, frequency, and pain on urination, but they don't have an infection, and the symptoms don't go away.
So if it's not an infection, then antibiotics aren't successful.
Antibiotics are not successful.
I know we don't have a cure for it, and we don't really know the cause for it, but there are some scientific advances now, I guess, in finding out what the cause might be. Explain them to us.
Yeah, the theories now that are the most popular and that people are looking into seriously are either there's a defect in the lining of the bladder that allows urine to sort of back diffuse into the bladder muscle itself and set up an inflammation, or that there's actually something wrong with the urine itself. The urine is abnormal and is affecting an otherwise normal bladder and causing the problem.
All right, Dr. Ratner, you went to, I think, some 14 doctors before they could finally diagnose this. An incredible thing you went through. What was it like for you yesterday to be at this conference, being a victim, being someone who has worked so hard for public awareness?
Yeah. Well, I think because I'm a physician as well as a patient with this disease, I, of course, reacted on two different levels. It was, of course, very exciting to have the first conference ever held on this disease, and very impressive that top researchers from all over the country and all over Europe came for a one-day meeting. On the other hand, as a patient, I'm human, and just like anybody else, I would have hoped that someone would stand up and say, I think I have the answer.
Oh,
and of course, there was a terrible disappointment on a certain level. That there, in fact, not only wasn't an answer, but there was a lot of conflicting data that was presented.
But so it's come a long way since you two were here on our program before. Tell us what the response was the last time you were on.
Okay. We had an enormous response after our interview here last year. We received over 10,000 letters from people all across the country. Of course, not all of them had the disease, but...
Were they going through a similar type of thing that you went through, going from doctor to doctor to doctor and nobody being able to figure it out, and in fact telling you this, I don't know, it's in your head, that it's really not
a very, very typical story of patients being told they were crazy, that it was psychosomatic and they should see a psychiatrist. For me, it was an enormous relief to know that I wasn't alone, that there were thousands other out there like myself who could work with me.
Well, how much more aware do you think that doctors in general are today? First of all, you go ahead first.
Okay. I personally think that we have a long way to go. It's very exciting that research has started. They're exploring new avenues. But at the same time, for the person out there in the community, I think it's very difficult to get the diagnosis.
Dr. Hanno?
I would tend to disagree with that. I think that there's much higher awareness of the disease among physicians and among patients. And at the recent American Urologic Association meeting, there was a lot of time spent on it, and also at this meeting that we had in Boston.
For those out there who either have it or are suffering with it or think they might have it, what kind of a treatment is there?
The treatments involve either distension of the bladder under anesthesia, blowing it up like a balloon, or putting medication into the bladder to relieve the symptoms, but there's no cure for the disease.
All right, well, thank you both very much. And for anyone at home, if you want more information about the disease, you can write to Interstitial Cystitis Association, P.O. Box 1553, Madison Square Station, New York, New York, 10159. And right now it's 22 minutes after. Next half hour, Judith Light of Who's the Boss. We'll be back.
She had to diagnose herself after seeing numerous physicians who couldn't label her symptoms. Here with that report, correspondent Ken Rosenberg.
28-year-old Vicki Ratner is an orthopedic surgery resident at the Montefiore Medical Center in New York City. Like most first-year residents, she spends the majority of her waking hours in the hospital. But occasionally, Dr. Ratner may be found on national television or on radio. That's because Dr. Vicki Ratner is mounting a media campaign to educate the public about a disease called interstitial cystitis, a debilitating bladder illness that she herself developed several years ago, a disease, she says, that most doctors have ignored.
I mean, it was the most excruciating pain I ever had in my life. And they were telling me that it was stress or that I should see a psychiatrist. One urologist even told me that I should quit medical school and get married. And that actually happened to me. I mean, this is not made up. And finally, what I did was go to the library myself, and I researched everything out, and I came across several articles. And it's a good thing that I had found those articles, or I think I really would have gone crazy. And it described a certain test that had to be done. And I brought the papers back to my original urologist.
On examination, Vicky's urologist found small petechial hemorrhages on her bladder wall. Finally, the diagnosis of interstitial cystitis was made. But few women are ever accurately diagnosed. Many are told their symptoms are psychological. Most end up feeling embarrassed and isolated.
It's a closet disease. You know, nobody, it's an embarrassing disease. Nobody wants to come out publicly and say, well, I haven't been able to have intercourse in 10 years and my husband's left me, or I can't leave the house because I can't make it to the supermarket because I can't, there's no bathroom at the supermarket. I mean, nobody, you know, wants to say these things. But in fact, this is what's happening. And there are thousands and thousands of women all across the United States that have this disease. Mm-hmm. Urologists insist that it's rare, and they are missing the diagnosis.
Dr. Jerry G. Blavis strongly disagrees with Dr. Ratner. Blavis is director of neurourology at the Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center in New York City. He says that interstitial cystitis is rare and that most women, including Vicky, probably have a less severe syndrome with a major psychological component, an illness he treats with behavioral modification.
And in those patients, the first treatment that we recommend is a structured course of behavior modification, which means they see a trained behaviorist who specifically knows how to deal with these bladder problems, and we try to teach them to avoid at more acceptable intervals. It sounds awfully simplistic and awfully psychiatric or psychological. I don't believe that this is primarily a psychiatric disorder. I do believe that lots of the patients, because they've seen so many doctors, have developed secondary psychological problems because of it, but nevertheless, the bottom line is that we found this to be very, very, very successful, and the overwhelming majority of patients that come with this syndrome of frequent urination because it hurts if they don't. We think a lot of it is kind of a learned behavior that can be unlearned through the behavioral modification.
But Dr. Ratner claims that Dr. Blavis is underestimating the problem. She supports her argument by citing the numerous letters she has received from women across the country.
In the past 6 months, my condition has intensified to the point where I am unable to function as a normal human being. Crippled with pain, I have been unable to pass the California bar exam, unable to work, and have had to cease all sexual activity with my husband. In the past few weeks, I have been bedridden with pain. I hardly think that behavior modification or biofeedback is going to help this person.
You know, many of them have exactly that attitude. You know, well, you're not going to help me because I have, my urethra's on fire. Well, with that attitude, it's very difficult to treat. There's symptoms, and there's the reaction to the symptoms.
But the tide of expert opinion is shifting towards Vicky's side.